Good morning. I usually do this earlier, but life gets in the way. So we are reading The Last Vampire, Book 2. Black Blood. Amazing. Okay, what has happened? Last time, Alyssa was confronted with a group of other vampires, and that was the whole reason she went to LA from Oregon. And she battled a vampire that was more powerful than her, and she thought she was the last. She suspects this person has Kafka's blood, the original vampire, but now she is walking along the street and is confronted by a police officer. So, let's see. A young man, he has blonde hair, almost as light as my own, blue eyes as well, although these are darker than mine. He wears a sea blue sport coat. This is the FBI agent. Expensive white slacks. He is strikingly handsome. I feel, as I climb in beside him, like an actor in his series, Agent Vampire. There should be such a show. His face is tan, his features sharp and intelligent. He studies me in the dome light before shutting the door. He notices that I am soaking wet. Although, once again, the blood stains on my black outfit are all but invisible. The other officers drive off. What's your name? He asks. Alyssa Perm. Where's your car? I don't know exactly. I've been walking for an hour. Lost. You say you got hit with water balloons thrown at you by a bunch of guys. You expect me to believe that? Yes, I say. And I catch his eye. Such beautiful eyes, really. I hesitate to blunt his will too forcefully, afraid it might damage him. Yet he is strong. He will not be moved without great power. Nevertheless, I cannot let him take me in for questioning. I lowering my voice, I pitch my tone in such a manner that he will feel as if I am speaking between his ears, as if he were, in fact, thinking what I am saying. I have done nothing wrong, I say gently. Everything I tell you is true. I am a young woman, helpless, a stranger here. The best thing you can do is take me to my car. Suggestive. He considers what I say for several seconds. I know my voice runs like an echo inside him. Then he shakes himself, seemingly throwing off my implant. I can sense his emotions, although I cannot read his thoughts. His doubt remains strong. Okay. So Alyssa can read emotions. Akasha can read thoughts. His doubt remains strong. He reaches out and shuts his door. The engine is already running. Have you been inside the Colosseum tonight? He asked. No. What's inside the Colosseum? Never mind. The police say they found you here, in the parking lot. What are you doing here? Fleeing from the guys who harassed me. How many were there? I'm not sure. 3 or 4. We have a report from 2 young men in the area. They say their buddy was attacked by someone who fits your description. Minutes ago, we found their body lying in a gutter. What do you have to say about that? I grimace. I know nothing about it. How did he die? Joel frowns violently. I shake my head, looking anxious. I was just trying to get back to my car. Can't you take me there? It's been a long night for me. Where are you from? Oregon. I don't know L.A. I took a wrong exit, and then my car stalled. But with your help, I might be able to find it. I reach over and touch his arm, holding his eyes once more, but softly, without fire. Please, I say. Ooh. He nods finally, puts the car in gear. Which exit did you get off? I forgot the name. It's up here. I can show you. And maybe we can retrace my steps. I point as we pull out of the parking lot and head north in the direction of the freeway. Honestly, I've never hurt anyone in my life. He chuckles barely. I don't imagine you had anything to do with what happened tonight. I've heard L.A.'s a violent town. He nods grimly. Especially lately. I suppose you've read the papers? Yes. Are you in charge of the murder investigation? Several of us are overseeing it. Have you any leads? No. But that's off the record. I smile. I'm not a reporter, Agent Drake. He smiles faintly. You shouldn't get within 20 miles of this area at night. How long are you going to be in L.A.? Why? We might need to ask you more questions later. I'll be around. I can give you a number once we find my car. That's fine. Did you get off the Harbor Freeway or the Santa Monica? I was on the Santa Monica Freeway. Let's continue north a few blocks. I think I'll recognize the right street. How old are you, Lisa? 22. What's your business in L.A.? I'm visiting friends. I'm thinking of going to school here next year. Oh, where? USC. The Coliseum is right next to USC. That's the reason I was driving around here. One of my friends lives on campus. I shiver again. But with all this violence, I'm seriously reconsidering my choice of universities. That's understandable. He glances over, checking out my body this time. He does not wear a wedding ring. So you're a student. What are you majoring in? History, I say. We drive without talking for a few minutes, me merely pointing where I think we should turn next. Actually, I do not want to take him to my car because even though he is responding to my suggestions, he still has a will of his own, and he obviously highly trained. He can memorize my license plate number if I brought him to my rental. A block from where I have parked, passing a red Honda, I signal for him to stop. This is it, I say, opening the car door. Thank you so much. Do you think it will start now, he asks. Why don't you pull in front of me and wait to see if I can get it started, I add, a sexy note in my voice. Could you do that for me? Oh my gosh, the helpless dame. No problem. Alyssa, do you have an ID on you? I grin foolishly. I knew you were going to ask that. I'm afraid I'm driving without my license, but I can give you a number where I'll be tomorrow. It's 310-555-4141. This is a genuine LA number that will ring through to my house in Oregon. You can call me there any time for the next 3 days. Do you want me to write the number down for you? He hesitates, but I know he is thinking that my license plate number, he can always trace me. That's not necessary. It's an easy number to remember. He pauses again, studying the damp marks on my shirt. There is no way he can tell their bloodstains just by looking at them. But I have to wonder if he can smell the odor. Even after my heavy washing, despite my subtle influence, he would never let me go if he definitely saw blood. And I am not free yet. Can you give me an address as well, he asks. Joel, I say in a special way. You don't really think I killed anyone, do you? He breaks away silently. No. Then, why do you want all these things from me? He hesitates, shrugs. If you have an address, I will take it. Otherwise, your phone number is enough for me for now. Yes. We'll probably talk tomorrow. Good enough. It was nice meeting you. I step out of his car. Now I just hope the damn thing starts. Joel pulls in front of me and waits, as I suggested. It was not a suggestion I made willingly, but felt I needed to allay his suspicions. The Honda door is locked, but I open it with a hard yank and slip behind the wheel. With two fingers, I break the ignition switch, noting how Joel studies my license plate number in his rearview mirror. He writes it down as I press the contact wires together and the engine turns over. I wave as I quickly pull away from the curb. I don't want the people in the adjacent house to hear me leaving with their car. After driving around the block, I get into my own car in less than an hour. I am in the air, flying in my personal Learjet toward Oregon, yet I know I will return to Los Angeles soon to finish the war with the powerful vampire, for good or evil. Oh my. That was a long chapter. Now it is chapter 2. So she's now back in Oregon. Ray is not home when I get there. Our residence is new, obviously, since my original house blew up with Yaksha inside. Our modern mansion in the woods is not far from the old house. It has many electronic conveniences, a view of the ocean, heavy drapes to block out the midday sun. More than any other vampire I have known, Ray is the most excruciatingly sensitive to the sun. He is made like a Bram Stoker model vampire out of old legends. Many things about his new existence trouble him. He misses his school friends, his old girlfriend, and especially his father. But I can give him none of these things, certainly not his father, since it was I who killed the man. I can only give him my love, which I dreamed would be enough. I am only in the house 2 minutes before I am back in the car looking for him. Dawn is in an hour away. I find him sitting on his ex-lover's porch, but Pat McQueen is unaware of his nearness. Along with her parents, she is sleeping inside. I know she thinks Ray perished in the blast that supposedly took my life too. He sits with his head buried in his knees and doesn't even bother to look up as I approach. I let out a sigh. What if I was a cop? I ask. He looks up his I can never pronounce that word, consuming his beauty. Yet my heart aches to see him again. It has ached over ever since he entered my life. But the physical heart and the emotional one, Radha, Krishna's friend, once told me that longing is older than love and that one cannot exist without the other. Her name, in fact, meant longing, and Krishna's meant love, but I never saw how their relationship tortured them the way my passion for Ray does me. I have given him the kingdom of eternal night, and all he wants to do is take a walk under the sun. I note his weakness, his hunger. 6 weeks, and I'm still forcing him to feed, even though we don't harm or kill our meals. He doesn't look happy to see me, and that saddens me more. If you were a cop, he says, I could easily disarm you and create a scene doing it. He nods to the blood on my top. It looks as if you have created a scene or two tonight. When I don't respond, he adds, How is Los Angeles? I will tell you back in the house I turn. Come. No. I stop, glance over my shoulder. The sun will be up soon. I don't care. You will when you see it. He doesn't answer me. I go and sit beside him, put my arm around his shoulder. Is it Pat? You can talk to her, you know, if you must. I just think it's a bad idea. He shakes his head. I cannot talk to her. Then what are you doing here? He stares at me. I come here because I have nowhere else to grieve. Ray, I mean, I don't know where my father's buried. He turns away and shrugs. It doesn't matter. It's all gone. I take his hand. He barely lets me. I can take you to where I buried your father, but it's just a hole in the ground, covered over. It will not help you. He looks up at the stars. Do you think there are vampires on other planets? I don't know. Maybe. In some distant galaxy, there might be a whole planet filled with vampires. This planet almost was. He nods. Except for Krishna. Yes, except for him. He continues to stare at the sky. If there were such a planet, where there were only vampires, it would not survive long. They would destroy one another. He looks at me. Do I do that to you? Destroy you? Interesting question. I shake my head sadly. No. You give me a great deal. I just wish I knew what to give you in return to help you forget. He smiles gently. I don't want to forget, Sita. And maybe that is my problem. He pauses. Take me to his grave. We won't stay long. Are you sure? Yes. I stand, offer him my hand. Very well. We drive into the woods. I lead him through the trees. I remember the spot where I buried P.I. Michael Riley. Of course, I remember everything. Also, I smell the faint fumes of his decaying body as they seep up from beneath 6 feet of earth. I fear Ray smells them as well. The life of a vampire is a life of many corpses. They do not invoke in me the strong emotions they do in most humans. Ray drops to his knees as we reach the spot. I retreat a few dozen feet because I want him to be alone with his emotions, a cauldron of sorrows. I am still weak to let them wash over me, or else I am too guilty. I hear Ray weep, dry tears on a missing tombstone. My two most recent wounds have completely healed, but my chest continues to burn. That's because of a stake that was driven through her heart. She survived. A vampire survives the impaling of a stake through her heart. I remember the night Ray pulled the stake from my heart while my house burned nearby. Barely conscious, I didn't know if I would live or die, and for the next 3 days, Ray didn't either, because even though my wound closed quickly, I remained unconscious. All that time, I had the most extraordinary dream. I was in a starship flying through space. Ray was beside me, and our destination was the Pleiades star cluster, the Seven Sisters, as it is often called by astronomers. Outside our forward portals, we could see the blue-white stars growing steadily in size and brilliance, and although our journey was long, we were filled with excitement the whole time, because we knew we were finally returning home to where we belonged, where we weren't vampires, but angels of light who lived on the radiance of the stars alone. The dream was painful to awaken from, and I still pray each time I lie down to sleep that it will return. The color of the stars reminded me of Krishna's eyes. Ray spills his grief quickly. We are back in the car and headed for home as the eastern sky begins to lighten. My lover sits silently beside me, staring at nothing, and my own dark thoughts keep my lips closed. My energy is at low, but I know I mustn't rest, not until I have formulated a plan to stop the Black Plague spreading 600 miles south of us. He of wicked eyes will make more vampires the next night, I know. Replacements for the ones I destroyed, and they, in turn, will make their own. Each day, each hour is crucial. The human race is in danger. Krishna, I pray, give me the strength to destroy this enemy. Give me the strength not to destroy myself. As Ray lies down to rest, I let him drink from my veins, a little, enough to get him through the day. Even that mouthful drowns me more. Yet I do not lie down beside him as he closes his eyes to sleep. Let him dream of his father, I think. I will tell him Los Angeles later. Ooh. So, what is going to happen? I visit my friend Seymour Dorston. Twice I have seen him since I destroyed the AIDS virus in his blood with a few drops of mine. His health is greatly improved. He has a girlfriend now, and I tell him I am jealous, but he doesn't believe me. I climb in his window and wake him by shoving him off his bed and onto the floor. I'm sorry. That is funny. So she climbs in the window and throws him off his own bed. He grins as his head contacts the hardwood with a loud thud. Only my Seymour would welcome such treatment. I was dreaming about you, he says, his blankets half covering his face. Did I have my clothes on, I ask? Of course not. He sits up and rubs the back of his head. What the eyes have seen, the mind cannot forget. When did you ever see me naked, I ask, although I know the answer. He chuckles in response. I do not fool him. Seymour the Great, my personal biographer, knowing our psychic bond, I wonder if he has spent the night writing about my trials. But he shakes his head when I ask. He watched a video with his new girl and went to bed early. I tell him about Los Angeles, why I am bloody. Wow, he says when I am done. I lean back on his bed, resting my head against the wall. He continues to sit on the floor. You're going to have to do better than that, I say. He nods. You want me to help you figure out where they're coming from. They're coming from that monster. I have no doubt about that. I want to know where he come from. I shake my head. I thought about it all the way here, and I have no explanation. There is always an explanation. Do you remember the famous Sherlock Holmes quote? When you have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, no matter how improbable, must be the truth. So true. Seymour thinks, his palm pressed together. A vampire that strong could only have been created by Yaksha. Yaksha is dead. Also, Yaksha would not have created a vampire. He was bound by the vow he made to Krishna. He spent the last 5,000 years destroying them. How do you know Yaksha is dead? Maybe he survived the blast. Highly unlikely, but not impossible. That's my point. Yaksha was the only one besides you who could make another vampire, unless you want to bring in the possibility that another Yakshini has been accidentally invoked into the corpse of a pregnant woman. Don't remind me of that night, I growl. You're in a bad mood, but I suppose being stabbed twice in the same night with your own knife would do that to anybody. I smile thinly. Are you making fun of me? You know I'm thirsty. I could open your veins right now and drink my fill, and there would be nothing you could do about. Seymour is interested. Sounds kinky. Should I take off my clothes? I throw a pillow at him hard. It almost takes off his head. Haven't you been able to get that girl of yours into bed? What's wrong with you? With my blood in your veins, you should be able to have who you want when you want. He rubs his head again, probably thinking it is going to be sore for the rest of the day. How do you know I haven't slept with her yet? I can spot a male virgin a mile away. They walk like they've been riding a horse too long. Let's return to our problem. Yaksha would not have made this guy. It's out of the question. Yet you are right. Yaksha is the only one who could have made him. A paradox. How do I solve it? How do I destroy this creature that clearly has at least twice my strength and speed? Tell me, young author, and I might let you live long enough to enjoy a carnal pleasure with me, pleasure with this silly girl you have foolishly chosen over me. I'm sorry. I can't answer your questions, but I can tell you where you must look to find the answers. Where? Where you left the trail last. Where you last saw Yaksha. He went up in the blast you set in your house, but even dynamite leaves remains. Find out what became of those remains, and you might find out how your new enemy came to be. I nod. His reasoning is sound as always, but even if I learn how he came to be, I still have to learn how to destroy him. You will. Yaksha was a more difficult foe. He knew at least as much as you about what a vampire could or could not do. The way this guy's carrying on, he must be newborn. He is still learning what he is. He doesn't know where he is weak. Find him. Strike at that weak point, and he will fall. I slip onto the floor and kneel to kiss Seymour on his lips. Gently, I toss up his hair. You are so confident in me, I say. Why is that? He starts to say something funny, but his expression falters. He trembles slightly beneath my touch. Is he really that bad? He asks softly. Yes. You are strong when you say Yaksha was a more difficult foe. In his own way, Yaksha was a protector of mankind. This guy is a psychopath. He is bent on destroying all humanity, and he could succeed. If I don't stop him soon, nothing will. But you saw him only briefly. I looked deep into his eyes. I saw enough. Believe what I tell you. Seymour touches my face, admiration and love in his eyes. I have confidence in you because when you met me, I was as good as dead and you saved me. You are the hero in my story. Find him, Sita. Corner him. Then kick his ass. It'll make for a great sequel, he adds seriously. God will help you. I squeeze his hand carefully, feeling once more my weakness, my pain. It will not leave me, I am certain, until I leave this world. The temptation is there before me for the first time, to just run and hide in oblivion. Yet I know I must not, I cannot. Like Yaksha, I have one last duty to perform before I die and return to the starry heaven of my dream, or to a cold hell. But I do not like the cold. No vampire does. Like snakes, it slows us down. I fear the devil will help him, I say, and I'm not sure who's stronger. Oh my gosh. What time is it? Okay. Chapter 3. Ooh. So we have one. So what do you think? You think Tristile will find him? Let's find out. The sun is firmly in the sky as I sit in my office to sort out what to do next. Three types of professionals arrive after my house blew up 6 weeks earlier. Firefighters, police officers, and paramedics. Ray told me this. They didn't talk to Ray, who had dragged me out of sight into the woods, but I contacted them later once I had regained consciousness. I pleaded innocent to any knowledge of the explosion, its cause or the reason it was rigged. At that time, they didn't tell me of any human remains found in the vicinity. That, of course, doesn't mean a body wasn't found. The police could have withheld that information from me. For all I know, I'm still under investigation for the explosion and whatever was discovered in the area. I need a contact with the local police, and I need it immediately. The paramedics in the hospital would have the remains of Yaksha. But if I do not go through the proper channels and authorities, they will show me nothing. With my extensive contacts and wealth, I can develop a contact, but it will take time. As I sit at my desk thinking, a light on my phone begins to blink. It is an out-of-state call. I pick it up. Yes, I say. Alyssa? Yes, Agent Jake. Joel Drake. How nice of you to call. I make a decision immediately, figuring it is a sign from Krishna that the FBI man has phoned at this precise instant. Of course I do not believe in signs. I am just desperate. I've been meaning to call you. There are some things we should discuss that I failed to bring up last night. He is interested. Such as, I have a lead on who is behind the murders. He takes a moment. Are you serious? Yes, I have a very good lead. What is it? I will only tell you in person. Fly into Portland this afternoon and I will pick you up at the airport. I guarantee you'll be glad you came. I thought you said you wouldn't be leaving town for a few days. I lied. Call the airlines. Book your flight. He chuckles. Hold on a second. I can't fly up to Oregon in the middle of an investigation. Tell me what you know, then we can talk. No, I say firmly. You must come here. Why? The murderer is from here. How do you know that? I pitch my voice in my most beguiling manner. I know many things, Agent Drake. That one of the guys you found in the Coliseum had a javelin through his chest. The other had the skull stabbed open, and every bone in the neck of the third was shattered. Don't ask me how I know these things. And don't tell your FBI pals about me. Not if you want to solve the case and get all the credit. Think about it, Joel. You can be the big hero. My knowledge stuns him. He considers. You misunderstand me, Alyssa. I don't need to be a hero. I just want to stop the killing. He is being sincere. I like that. It will stop if you come here, I say softly. He closes his eyes. I hear them close. My voice will not leave his mind. He wonders if I am some kind of witch. Who are you? He asks. It doesn't matter. I will hold while you book your flight. Take the earliest one. I will have to tell my partners where I'm going. No, just the two of us are going to work on this. That's my condition. He chuckles again, this time without mirth. You're pretty gutsy for a young woman. I think of the knife that stabbed me in the belly less than 12 hours ago. I have strong guts, I agree. Joel puts me on hold. A few minutes later, he returns. His plane will land in 3 hours. I agree to meet him at the gate. After setting down the phone, I leave my office and crawl into bed beside Ray. He stirs and turns his back to me, but doesn't wake. Portland is an hour and a half away. I have only 90 minutes to rest before I must take on the enemy. Joel looks tired when I pick him up at the airport. I don't imagine he got much sleep the previous night. He immediately starts with his questions, but I ask him to wait until we are in my car. Once inside, I put on music, a tape of my playing the piano. We drive toward my Mayfair. I am still thinking how I should approach this matter. Since we are dealing with evidence that points toward a mysterious agency, I am not worried about staying conservative. Who is the pianist? He asks finally. Do you like it? The music is haunting. The pianist is wonderful. An appropriate choice of words. It's me. Are you serious? You have asked me that twice today. I'm always serious, Agent Drake. Joel, please. Is Alyssa your real name? Why? Have you been researching me? A bit. I haven't turned up much. You mean you haven't turned up an Alyssa Pern in your computers? That's correct. What's your real name and who taught you to play such exquisite piano? I am self-taught, and I like to be called Alyssa. You haven't answered my question. I answered one of them. He stares at me. For a few sentences, I forgot to be careful how I pitch my voice, and the echo of my age creeps into it. My words and voice, I know, can throb like living ghosts. My music is not the only thing that is haunting. How old did you say you were? He asked. Older than I look. You want to know how I know about the murders? Among other things, you lied to me last night when you said you had been in the Colosseum. That is, you had not been in the Colosseum. That is correct. I was there. I saw the three young men in the field killed. Did you get a good look at the killer? Good enough. He pauses. Do you know him? No. But he is associated with a man I once knew. The man died in an explosion at my house 6 weeks ago. The reason I have brought you here is to help me trace the remains of that man. We are driving to the Mayfair police station now. I want you to ask them to open the files to you. He shakes his head. No way. You're going to answer my questions before I do anything to help you. Or you will arrest me? Yes. I smile thinly. That will not happen, and I am not going to answer all your questions. Just the ones I choose to answer. You have no choice but to cooperate with me. Like you said last night, you have no leads, and you are more in the dark than you admit. You have several people who seem to have been killed by a person of extraordinary strength. A person so strong, in fact, that he seems superhuman. I wouldn't go that far. I snort softly. It takes a great deal of strength to snap every cervical in a man's neck. Isn't that what the autopsy show? Joel shifts uneasily. But I have his full attention. The autopsy isn't complete on any of the victims. But the LAPD medical examiner has told you about the guy's neck. It makes you wonder, doesn't it? He speaks carefully. Yes. Makes me wonder how you know these things. I reach over and touch his leg. I have a very sensual touch when I wish to flaunt it. And I must admit, I find myself attracted to Joel. Not that I love him as I do Ray, but I wouldn't mind seducing him as long as Ray wouldn't know. Having had 10,000 lovers, I don't share most mortals' illusions of the sacredness of fidelity. Yet I will not risk hurting Ray for sex, and I will not lie to him anymore. Joel feels the electricity of my fingers and shifts all the more. I like my boys fidgety. Want me to say something? I ask, my hand still on his thigh. He clears his throat. You are very alluring, Alyssa, particularly when you are being vague or trying to be persuasive. He stares down at my hand as if trying to decide whether it's a priceless jewel or a spider that has crawled into his lap. But I'm beginning to see through your facade. I remove my hand, not insulted. Is that all it is? A facade? He shakes his head. Where did you grow up? I burst out laughing. In the jungle, a place not unlike where these murders are happening. I watched as that young man's neck was snapped. A normal person couldn't do that. The person you are looking for is not normal. Nor was my friend who died when my house blew up. If we find what became of him, his remains, then we can find your murderer, I hope. But don't ask me how these people are not normal, how they have such strength, or even why my house was blown up. I won't tell you. He keeps looking at me. Are you normal, Alyssa? He asks. What do you think? No. I pat his leg. It's all right. You go on thinking that way, yet I think he knows too much about me already. When all this is over, I'm going to have to kill Joel Drake. All right. Well, tomorrow we will be reading chapter 4. And thank you for joining me today. And tomorrow we'll start reading chapter 4. And if you like YA horror mystery adventures with vampires and teen romance that is spooky and creepy, like Goosebumps and Fear Street, you may like Vampire Juice. And this is the short synopsis. Amanda and Sean stumble upon the mysterious can of juice while searching for Halloween costumes at a local store. Despite being kicked out by the sales clerk, they become obsessed with uncovering the truth behind the strange drink. With the help from some local bullies, they sneak back into the store through a crypt in the graveyard, only to find themselves in the midst of a spine-chilling adventure. My link is in the bio and is only 99 cents until January 1st. Thanks for watching.